I remember back to when I was like 12 years old. The first time for me when I really got passionate about something. You know, passionate about something that gave me the confidence to feel like I could do anything. So I went into this interview process with 500 applicants, and they're only taking 25. So the 25 applicants that they were taking, they were supposed to be the best of the best. And I didn't know anything about programming websites. So I picked up a magazine before going into the interview, and it was on VRML, this language that was beyond HTML, but I didn't know HTML either. So I read it and went into the interview. It was kind of a fake until you make it thing. I said, oh yeah, don't worry about that HTML stuff. The VRML is where it's at. And I started talking about that kind of deflection, but confidence into myself, knowing that if I did get the job, I could read book and figure it out and make it happen. So it was really pivotal for me to go into that job, figure it out, read a whole bunch, and then create something that this community program enabled me to do. We ended up winning. So that put us in front of, we won the business magazine. It gave us the confidence to one more affirmation to know that we could do anything. Dove deep into things that, you know, from 12 to 17, 18, that kids just didn't dive into. I dove into books that were for adults and books that were for people much greater. It's like, you know what, I can figure it out, it's okay. And listening to some engineers and getting great conversations with engineers going, that they had problems in connecting computers to pull out the data out of all the automation equipment. I said, well, you know, you could just do it this way. This would be the way you do it. I'm like, oh, okay, that's crazy. Why don't you apply? So I applied. And then worked with Central Engineering for 6 years at Ford. And they sent me to school for everything. Because they also had confidence in me in some early projects I worked really hard at to be able to be successful for them. They sent me for programming, for automation, for project management, for management, just kept sending me to school because I invested in them, so they invested in me. Now I was working.
So a group of really brilliant psychologists in the field of expertise research have sat down and tried to figure out how long do you have to work at something before you become really good, right? And the answer seems to be, it's an extraordinarily consistent answer in an incredible number of fields, and that is, you need to have practiced, to have apprenticed for 10,000 hours before you get good.
Dedicating yourself to what you're doing and not necessarily seeing the benefit right away. You're not going to see it right away. The benefit is going to be when you get out of it, even if they don't ever give you anything. You've gained all that knowledge. So employers are going to enable you to gain the knowledge, but they're just your stepping stone into entrepreneurship. They're going to give you the context, they're going to give you the contacts. You know, you kind of look at the space in between, you know, you've got pillars, imagine how pillars, and you know, there's there's Pinterest that has pictures, and there's YouTube that has video, and there's, you know, Facebook that has people, and there's Twitter that has topics and hashtags, and there's spaces in between those pillars that I kind of sat and looked at. I was like, well, where's the places? There's you know, there's people, there's pictures, and there's no spot for me to be able to go say, I want all the media that's coming out of the Blue Jays game, or I want all the media that's coming from the 5 resorts I want to travel to in Thailand, right? And I don't want to see what the resort's telling me. I want to see what the people are saying about the resorts. I don't want to look at those reviews, those whatever they put under there, because right, the perception is that some of them are real and some of them are marketing. So I could visualize any spot on earth through pictures, media, and text through tweets. Long story short, ended up transforming that from a public social media system into something for law enforcement. When you come up with at the start is not always going to be what it's going to be, but just, you know, you're going to find that niche if you're constantly thinking about how how you can use the product outside of your initial thoughts. You need to be very open to what your products are. Content from your service, which we backfill content for them, then you've solved your problem. And there's economies of scale as you start to bring all these advertisers together, and you're then getting the efficiency that not any one publisher could get. Partnerships are really big in this, right? Because you can't do everything. Now where we're creating unique videos, we create about 150 a month on the delicious, crafty, and Flawless channel, which is the beauty channel. Crafty is the DIY channel, and Delicious is the food channel. In the top 15 in France at one point. We didn't really hone in on the English market before expanding it. That was a mistake we made. That's something that I would definitely do differently. So I would hone the product first and then go back on, is to establish your brand. So at the start, you know, you're going to say to people whatever your brand name is, in this case, Dibley. And you know, how many people out of 10 are you meeting that actually know what that means? And how many people out of 10, if they do know what it means, have a positive reaction to your brand? I walked them through three steps. So the first thing I told them was, you know, give knowledge. The ability for you to understand what the value is in your business, whether you're running a yoga instructor business, or whether you're selling comic book cards, or you're selling billiard equipment, right? You have an inherent skill, an inherent knowledge that you could give back to the community. The next one was give community. So you can imagine that there's a lot of chatter about either your business or your topic, unless you're creating a community around it. So he created a Facebook group around discussions around billiards and discussions around products that people were purchasing, so they could go ask questions to the community. The next thing was, give service. So during calls that he would get or orders that he'd get online, he would call them. Like, there was not one order at one point on his site that he would get a virtual order, he would call them on the phone. You're Manning from Manning Q's? Yes, you're calling me? I just placed an online order. He's like, yeah, I just wanted you to know about the product. It has these these features. I have this other product that performs just as well. It's about $100 less. And he said, well, when we're talking to them, aren't I gonna make less money if I tell them that? I was like, 100% you are. But they're gonna become advocates for your product. They're gonna post in this community. You're going to build a business that is going to be much greater than the $10 or $20 you just lost right now. Don't worry about that. Then he would also tell them after that call, hey, there's also a community, and he would constantly reinforce the sphere of influence he had. That. So now he's got that brand online. Because of that track, he's been in line for the past 2 years to do seven figures in revenue. It was a very simple concept. I dipped my finger in just the amount that I just told you guys. I wasn't there programming for him. I wasn't there every day talking to him about it. Mm-hmm. It was literally just those three things that transformed his business. The personal life side, you got to imagine, as I was going through this, also had two young kids during this time. They're now 2.5 and 4.5. Mm-hmm. And a very supportive wife. So I put myself on a schedule. Saturday is the important part. Told my wife, this is your time. Whatever you want to do, Saturdays are yours. That was really important to her because she knew I was dedicated the time. It was very important to the family. They knew that I would be there for them during that time. You need to keep up with your friends. For the past
15 years, I chose an intellectual or athletic hobby. So some of them being, you know, everything from building my own CNC machine to kiteboarding. Did 1 year and I just like, okay, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna travel to Dominican. Because that's the third best spot in the world for kiteboarding. Mm-hmm. They have school, I'm gonna start it, and then I'm gonna practice that 1 year. 1 year I did longboarding, another year I did dance, another year I built a home automation system. You know, I would just move around each year. 1 year I did skydiving. So I would just choose a sport and commit. I chose the dance because I couldn't dance at all. Find myself in a bad position all the time. Now I think I can dance, my wife tells me differently. But just push your boundaries, learn different things, and that's gonna create experiences, opportunity, and contacts as you move forward. Those contacts were so important for me as I moved outside of my